Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the 10th meeting of the Education and Skills Committee? Can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting? The first item of business is the first of four sessions on the committee's pre-budget scrutiny. Later this month, we will be looking at the Scottish Funding Council, the Scottish Qualifications Agency and Education Scotland. Today, we are looking at Skills Development Scotland. I welcome to the meeting Damien Yates, Chief Executive, Danny Logue, Operations Director, Gordon McGuinness, Director of Industry and Enterprise Networks, and Katie Hutton, Director of National Training Programmes. Before we start, I'd like to put on record the committee's thanks for SDS arranging a number of local visits for the members. Recently, Joanne, Richard, Daniel and I took the opportunity to see firsthand some of the work the SDS does, and I'm sure we all found it very useful, and I know that I did. So I'm going to start the questioning. Before I do, I'd just like to reiterate my thanks for the visit last Friday, week passing Friday. I did find it very useful and it was encouraging to see all the work that's going on here. But my question is around about the equalities. Could you tell us, I accept that the figures are improving, but could you give us an update on what it is that you're doing to improve the equality balance, you know, according to race and gender and disabilities?
I'll maybe start, Chair. Thanks again for the opportunity to present evidence. So just explain to the committee that all of the concerns and the ambitions that the Scottish Parliament have around equalities are taken incredibly serious by Skills Development Scotland and by the board. We have a formal subcommittee of our board, an equalities group that look horizontally across all of our services to ensure that we address any underrepresentation within the population. So in respect of our career services, we've got a very detailed action plan around enhancing and ensuring that those at disadvantage or at risk of being left behind are specifically supported and addressed through targeted services, and Danny Logue will offer some very detailed information on that. And in respect of national training programmes, the Modern Apprenticeship Programme in particular, Katie Hutton can explain in detail around the action plans that we have to ensure that there's increased representation of underrepresented groups in those programmes. I would remind the committee, and I think you're all familiar with this, that much of the challenge is a societal challenge. It's deep-seated, it's cultural, it's based on perceptions and views that are formed over many, many years. But there's a responsibility on all of us, not just Skills Development Scotland, but through employers, through parents, through teachers, through the whole system, to challenge some of those prejudices and views that we have, and to work hard every day of every week to ensure that we address them. So I'll maybe call on Danny first to speak in more detail about the impact of services in respect of those at risk in schools, and then Katie can speak more specifically on the improving uptake of modern apprenticeship across a range of equalities groups.
Thank you, Chair. A couple of points to highlight in terms of our school offer. We now have a whole school offer that now starts in P7S1, and that was the result of developing Scotland's young workforce. So there's a greater focus now in that earlier age group. And we also have our senior phase work, which is S4 to S6. So now what we have for the first time, in fact, anywhere in the OECD countries, we have a career service that works from P7 all the way through to S6. And in doing so, what that allows us to do is what we call earlier intervention. We're able to work with schools to identify young people with all different sorts of support needs that they may have. And that includes two aspects to that. One is about we have what we call a needs matrix, and we agree with that each year with the school to identify young people who potentially are at risk of not fulfilling a positive destination when they leave school, or they perhaps have some additional support for learning needs. And it's currently around about 28-29% of pupils between S4 and S6 who fall into that particular category. And as Damien indicated there, we offer a targeted support through our work coaches and career coaches in schools to offer a very intensive case management service. In addition to that, we've also been working with Education Scotland and schools around the career education standards, and that particularly is a career education standard from age 3 to 18. And we work very closely with teachers and with parents and how we can raise awareness of the world of careers, what that means and for all individuals, including some of the challenges that Damien mentioned there, whether it's additional support needs, whether it's issues around looked after and accommodated children. In fact, there's just under 5,500 young people with a care experience in secondary schools just now between S2 and S6 that we work with as well. And at the same time, we've been doing a lot of work, particularly with the Institute of Physics and other organisations, to try and address some of the quality issues around particular gender stereotyping in careers as well. So that very much forms the support our careers advisors and work coaches provide in school. In addition to that, we also have our My World of Work web service, and a lot of the emphasis and support in there is around how we support parents, how we support teachers and young people as well, in terms of raising awareness of what career opportunities are there right across the board, and to make sure we address issues around, for example, gender stereotyping.
There has been some movement, but you talked about, Damien, yes, you talked about societal values and having to change them, but at the end of the day, you're responsible for the apprenticeship programme. You're the one who has to be making that, to be pushing that change from your viewpoint. What steps are you doing, making to try and change the business, the perception from businesses that this is the right way to go?
Yeah, so just to say clearly, we wouldn't shirk our responsibility in that respect. So Katie will talk in detail about the very specific actions that we've taken, both with parents and young people, with training providers and with employers, to ensure that they're aware of their responsibilities. Because as much as we fund, we depend on employers then to put into place actions that respect and respond to the equalities agenda. So I'll maybe ask Katie to offer the committee some very specific details about the actions that we're taking and the improvements that we've seen in the last number of years.
Okay, so the first thing we did was engaged with our stakeholders, and a lot of that was around framing the challenge, understanding the challenge for each of the groups that are underrepresented in modern apprenticeships, and also for them to inform the activities that we would undertake. And what we've done is encapsulated that in an action plan, which does both. It shows our ambition and frames the challenge, as well as the activities and interim measures. The measures that we've taken are obviously specific to each group, but there are some common themes also going across what we do. So, for instance, when it comes to disability, we've got particular activities around things like funding support and additional support needs fund attached to an employability fund, and that's for things like a reasonable adjustments, like BSL interpreters, funding that, also things like coloured overlays, and also scribing pens and things like that for dyslexia too. We've also done a comprehensive suite of training and webinars informed by our stakeholders and delivered in many cases by our stakeholders to all the training providers too. And that's been going on, and that will continue to go on. And being on webinars, they can dip in and out of it when they want to. We've also undertaken a number of research projects around specific issues around working with partners like West College Scotland, Concept Northern around autism, working with Beath Community Development Trust around dyslexia, and I could go on. There's a range of action research projects, and the idea behind that was to understand how it works better so that we can inform the mainstreaming, because you can't keep doing project work all the time. So it was really about that too. We've also developed toolkit materials for all the advisors, which is used widely by partners too in disability. With employers, what we've done is we have both funded action research projects with them around what they can do to support and how we can then feed that out to other employers too. But also, what we've also done is we've produced a whole suite of materials too. We've produced little postcards, which has on one side of it the kind of things that employers might say, like, I don't get enough, the reason there's a gender imbalance, for instance, because I don't get enough recruits. And then on the back of it, it's things that they could do. We've invested a lot of resources ourselves in terms of personnel working in this and driving this through the business and also with training providers. And we've also added to our ITT documentation specific requirements around providing evidence about what people do in terms of equalities, training providers, employers, etc. And also each individual contractor for the National Training Programmes has to develop an equalities action plan and be seen to actively implementing it, and it's followed up by our skills investment advisors. And we've also supported our staff to be able to do that better too. So, I mean, I could go on at length here, but there's a whole range of actions, and obviously there's actions for each specific group too, around what we can do there. The figures have increased. Disability in particular, we always thought there was an issue around self-reported nature of disability. There's been work with the Equalities Challenge Unit in two areas there. One is to help train training providers and other suppliers to actually enable individuals to self-disclose. We know, for instance, that university students are happy to disclose a disability in a university setting, but when they go out into the labour market, they don't like to do it. So again, understanding that sort of thing. And it's about not asking people to self-declare a disability in a group setting. It's practical measures. And the other thing is around the way that you ask a question in a particular order and what we capture in terms of disability too. We've got Equalities Challenge units to speak to all the stakeholders involved and also benchmark against other countries too in terms of what's considered in terms of disability.
One of the very important developments I think that should help is, you know, in changing mindsets about a pathway that people think is not for them or for whatever reason, they just don't think they would have the courage or the belief that they could progress in that opportunity. So the introduction of foundation apprenticeships in senior phase in school, I think, offers a low-risk way for senior phase pupils to have a go at something that they maybe thought, you know, this wasn't for me. And the practicalities of both addressing, you know, the gender bias, but equally the equalities agenda through foundation apprenticeships and senior phase could be one of the most practical things that we deliver. So it changes both the mindsets of the individual and the parents and the teachers that this is possible, and that in fact, far from being something that they can't do, they actually thrive in it. And then equally, as Katie says, we have to every day of every week keep the pressure up on employers, on training providers, and keep this centre stage, because it's not a nice to, it's an absolute essential thing to follow through on.
And just a couple of questions around about that. I know a couple of my colleagues are going to ask questions on this as well, but how long has that been a focus? And have you seen any market improvement based on the work you've been doing, particularly the stuff that you mentioned, Katie? And do you have targets to reach in terms of these equality?
So we definitely, taking the first question, we have targets to reach that have been set through the youth employment strategy coming out of the recommendations of developing young workforce. And there's targets in relation to four specific groups to do with gender, disability, care leavers, and also ethnic minorities. So that, and we've also set ourselves interim targets in the way, and that's in our action plan. In terms of, we've certainly galvanised a lot of activity over the last couple of years there. I mean, I think it's interesting to contrast with, we've been talking to the Skills Funding Agency about their approach as part of it, and they don't see themselves, they're similar to us in terms of the funding of modern apprenticeships on behalf of UK government. And their approach is they don't see themselves as having a role in promoting equalities because it's the employer that recruits, and they don't see themselves as stepping in the way. And I suppose the approach here is to exhaust all the efforts we can as well in terms of the levers that we have. And also in terms of increases, so particularly for disability, at the end of 2014-15, 0.4% of individuals self-declared as being disabled. And we had done a wee bit of matching of our figures with our careers records and the Data Hub records that we have, and we always knew that there would have been an underreporting issue. It went up to 3.9% at the end of last year, and the quarter two figures came out yesterday, and it's up at 7.6%. And that's sustained from quarter one, because I'm always a wee bit cautious of mentioning quarter figures, because sometimes, you know, there's differences throughout the year it goes on, but it's being sustained this year at 7. And there's more to do, obviously, going forward. So there has been an increase there. Ethnic minority groups, there's been a slight increase there. And what we're learning there is, you know, we're up against quite strong cultural preferences with some ethnic minority groups around preferences to go to HE and FE. There's a culture in some ethnic minority groups around, you know, sacrifice now and you'll reap the rewards better going forward in the future. So if you look at 80% of ethnic minority groups go to HE and FE compared to 65% for all of the population. So you're up against that. So the kind of things that we've learned is definitely to engage ethnic minority groups on their home turf and community groups there. We've got, for instance, after Friday prayers in Edinburgh Central Mosque, we've got a stand there and everything to do that. We've been working with Bemis and Wesrec and other groups around engaging ethnic minority communities there as well in partner premises. And some cases, we've been driving awareness around apprenticeships, and then what is not necessarily matching into seeing figures improve is necessarily sometimes the it doesn't match up with their expectation of an opportunity. Or secondly, there's an employability skills provision there. So we've been working with, again, community groups to improve employability skills of some of the ethnic minority groups. So that's got, I think, quarter two. It was 1.4 at the end of last year. It's gone up slightly, 1.6%. That's going to be, you know, a lot of intensive work required there too. Care leavers, there wasn't a baseline for that, and we got one at the end of last financial year. That's 1% of all ME starts last year self-declared as being a care leaver. There isn't really a population, an agreed population figure in Scotland to reference that against, but we've got a baseline to work from, and it's about 1.1% just now too. Gender is a long-standing issue, and there's been multiple work over the years in terms of occupational segregation and ages reformed. It went up 1% in terms of overall participation, but you're still seeing that occupational segregation. A lot of the activities required to influence that are actually very much upstream of modern apprenticeships. It's starting in schools, nurseries, it's with parents influencing them. So I think that's a long haul there. And certainly if you look at European countries, you know, it's the same situation around occupational segregation.
You know, I'll give the chair an example. Participation in engineering apprenticeships, good quality engineering apprenticeships amongst young women is not nearly as high as we would like. So we looked really hard at what are the reasons for it. 2016, how can it be that we don't have a much more balanced participation in that? But one of the interesting statistics I think we reported at the last committee was that of young people in Scotland who get a pass or a higher grade in physics every year, 72% are boys. And so if you are not studying physics, then the likely progression into engineering is going to be highly restricted. And that's nothing to do with capacity and capability, because generally young women outperform young men in terms of progression into medicine and in other disciplines. So it's a perception, it's a belief that it's not a sector that they're interested in or they don't value, or that somehow or another their formative education or their influences on their life suggest that it's not for them. And so it's very deep-seated. In that example, we spend a lot of time engaging with the Institute of Physics around what are the outliers, where in the world do we have examples that we could draw on that would allow us to believe that we could change it. And the only significant outlier is actually in single-sex schools, which is bizarre, and I guess not bizarre in some respects, but, you know, we're certainly not going to move back to that. But there's a real challenge around the language and around how young women are engaged in that. One of the early seeds of hope in that space goes back to the point I mentioned around foundation apprenticeships, and I'd encourage maybe if the committee can get out into schools and have a look at some of the early pathfinders around foundation apprenticeships. But Lochgelly High School was one of the first to take on foundation apprenticeships in engineering, and the vast majority were young women. And the success of attracting them onto the programme was the change of language and the introduction of the words around design and so on that just broadened the appeal. And then having undertaken the foundation apprenticeship, then our hope is that people will migrate much more easily into pathways that they hadn't previously considered. But as I said, this is going to be, you know, a long-term challenge, and all of us right through the system are going to have to challenge the unconscious bias that we often maintain. People just through their language or through how they act and behave create an unconscious bias that's fed in.
Thank you very much. Before I pass you on to Joanne Lamont for some questions, I note today that the apprenticeships numbers came out, which seem very encouraging, but can you reassure us that this will help you to achieve your target?
Yeah, we'll not overstate the case, but at the end of quarter two, the figures are strong, and the progress towards the targets that we've just discussed, both at a high level and a very specific level, are in the right direction, and we remain confident that we can deliver on both the volume targets and the sub-targets that are set for the national training programmes.
Okay, thank you. John?
Thank you very much, and can I also put on record my thanks to the Wheatley Group and to SDS for the visit I had, and particularly struck with the enthusiasm of the people who were delivering the apprenticeship programme, but to the young people who came and spoke to us, who were just absolutely first class, and we'd want to wish them all well in the future, but was hugely impressed by that. Can I just go back to this issue about the question of equality in the delivery of your work. If there was an equality impact assessment on your spend, would it pass?
It's a good question. I think it would, in the sense of the resource that we have and how we're deploying that and the efforts that we're making. Are we seeing the absolute translation of that specifically in our programmes alone? I think the answer is no, because I go back to the point that Katie made. You know, to see the balance of choice inequalities across all of the skills programme is really required, because, you know, should it be that you have an absolute mirror of the population in every choice, or would it be that in some choices you have, you know, increased choices by women into medicine as opposed to apprenticeships? And for that reason, then, would the committee suggest that we dampen young women's enthusiasm for medicine and somehow plan and force them to choose apprenticeships over?
But that's not the choice we're talking about. It is that within your spending, if disproportionately the modern apprenticeships that are created are in subjects that girls are less likely to do, you're disproportionately funding the skills needs of boys. Now, that's not anything mm-hmm. against those boys mm-hmm. who made that choice. Mm-hmm. And yes, it's society and all the rest of it. However, in the direct spend by Skills Development Scotland, you're disproportionately investing in some groups as opposed to others. And so what we're trying to think about is what you're doing to address that question now. You made the point about giving extra support, but you said specifically around employability fund. So if you remind us what your broad budget is on modern apprenticeships and then the employability fund, what proportion of that funding is ring-fenced to deliver the supports that are required to make sure that people with disabilities can access modern apprenticeships or work through the employability fund?
We don't ring fence within the employability fund for specific actions around that. But what we try and do is look at the needs as we go along. There are other employability funded programmes across Scotland too that we would encourage, that partners are also funded through as well. And again, it's about linking all available employability funding programmes in Scotland and use that to help people. I think also in terms of what you're talking about with the gender related spend. We don't create the modern apprenticeship opportunities, they're jobs. So I think, in a sense, that suggests that what we're actually doing is saying, well, we're going to invest there and we're forgetting about all these other people. Well, the jobs have to be there. And also, it's a consequence of the recruitment choices that employers make. Now, we can exhaust the efforts that we can do, but then you would be getting into things like quotas, which I'm not sure that the employer community would be particularly in favour of, and telling people who to recruit, etc.
With respect, it would be reasonable for the public purse to expect its money to be dispersed in a fair way, and that if your position is this is not about us, this is about the employers, then what's the point of having a quality action plan?
Well, I think it's about both. I think you need to be extremely careful about the duality of what we're trying to do here. The apprenticeship funding is to support apprenticeships, which is a derived demand from employers. Government does not create apprenticeships. Employers create apprenticeships. Now, they set a target in the hope that industry will match that. It is a derived demand. Government can't force businesses to create apprenticeships.
But we can insist that the money that's spent by government is spent fairly across the quality groups.
Absolutely. So it's a jobs market. It's jobs that are created to support apprenticeships, which are funded. Thereafter, as we've said already, there's a whole range of sub-targets of which we have a real concern for. But I think somehow or another, splitting how the funds are spent by gender, I find that one a very difficult one to work out how we would do that.
It might be difficult, but with respect, it is the public purse. And if MD said to me, there's a fund created, and I can guarantee you that 70% of that money will go to boys rather than girls, that less than 5% will go to meet the needs of people with disabilities, I would have a concern about that. And I just wonder if that's something that, if when you've been asked to implement an equality action plan, you're actually working on.
I think also that also gets into the legalities of who you're choosing to give money to in terms of recruitment too. So there are some legal issues around, being disproportionately proactive with one particular group around recruitment, etc. So there are legal issues concerned with that too.
There are legal issues, but there is the Equality Act as well, which says that we should, that funds should be spent proportionately. So there is an issue about people with disabilities, an issue about women. Can I ask if you think there is an issue about age? Because we know that you've been asked to focus on 16 to 24-year-olds, but there are significant numbers of people in our communities who would, and indeed I think it's the CBI highlighted, that if there were more flexibility around age, we could address the question of people needing to be reskilled, or in fact people who have lost out at an early stage in their lives, who might take the opportunity to do an apprenticeship and get themselves into sustainable employment.
Yes, so happy to answer that question. I mean, Katie will go through the specifics of it. I think sometimes there's a misconception that adult apprenticeships are not available. They are available, and Katie can report on the actual figures around that. I think the Parliament and government should always reflect on changing economic cycles. Over the last 10 years, the focus has been on young people, and for very good reason. So I'd remind the committee that even today, the rate of unemployment among 16 to 24-year-olds as compared to the main employment stats is almost double. So young people are twice as likely to be out of the labour market than those older than them. And for that reason, for good reason, government then prioritises the investment around ensuring that young people progress into the labour market, not just by way of an individual benefit, but by way of preparing the future economy of Scotland, ensuring that we have the workforce that is being developed. As we look ahead, we completed a recent study called Jobs and Skills in Glasgow, and we look at the changing demographics, and we look at things like, you know, birth rates and the volumes of young people coming out of school, and we look at the staying on rates in the workplace, then I think there is an emerging priority, which is exactly around the area that you're talking around, which is how do we sustain older workers in the workplace and reskill them and constantly reskill them, because it feels like increasingly they'll be required in the labour market because of future demographics, but also from a personal point of view and pension progressions and so on, people will want that. So you'll see as part of the consultation around the current discussions on the apprenticeship levy, businesses were asked and others were asked to consult on the availability of apprenticeship funds to support people in work. And I think there was a resounding support from the business community to say that some of that apprenticeship money, levy money, should be directed towards more adults and more training in the workplace. So I think it's an emerging issue, and I definitely think it's going to be a significant priority. And in that respect, then government and the Parliament would want to wire funds maybe away from some areas and into other areas as those priorities emerge.
Last couple of points. I understand that you've got a target of reaching 30,000 modern apprenticeships by 2020 with an emphasis on technology. Do you think that target is going to help you reach the kind of issues around, or address the issues of equality? If there's going to be greater emphasis in sectors which are already, there's an occupational segregation, how are you going to address that?
It's a really, really good question, and I think it reflects the complexity of, you know, what we're trying to manage in respect of both the needs of the economy and the needs of individuals. I think some of our reflection, especially on the equalities agenda, is that, you know, we would want all of our citizens to be engaged in higher skilled, higher wage job opportunities. And when we look ahead at economic growth, there's a belief amongst all of the commentators that you speak to that there'll be an increasing demand for STEM-related careers and STEM-related skills. So it's certainly a target and an ambition and a priority that Scottish Government are very mindful of, and I'm sure this committee are very mindful of. But what we then need to do is to make sure that more and more of our young people and older workers are acquiring those skills to allow them to progress, both in terms of having pathways that have growth opportunities in them, and in terms of fulfilling the needs of the economy. So if everything remains as it is, then it could exacerbate the equalities agenda. And that's why we all have to work doubly hard to make sure that in across the breadth of STEM areas. And I think engineering is more pronounced in terms of gender segregation. What we find in biotechnologies and in more of the broad-based sciences, that it's actually the other way. So it depends on how that plays out. But ultimately, we would want all of the young people in Scotland having a fair opportunity to get careers in higher skilled, higher wage sectors, which typically are supported by the STEM sectors.
It is an issue of individual justice, but it's also about the untapped potential of a whole group of people who don't even think of these jobs. Final question, just on question of outcomes. I note that it says, we figure it says 92% of modern apprentice completers were in work 6 months later. I wonder, but we've also been told that 67% of employability fund leavers had achieved a positive outcome or output. What would be your explanation of why? Feels to me 67% is quite a low figure for people who have achieved a positive outcome from the employability fund.
I think a number of reflections on both of those. One is to remind the committee that I do think apprenticeships and work-based learning are probably amongst the best interventions that government can support, because they engineer the outcome into the process at the start of the process, which is a job, and it's a job that's derived from a need by an employer. And so the ability to sustain that success is built in right from the outset. The Employability Fund generally is targeted towards, much more targeted towards people in greater need who are distant from the labour market. It doesn't start with an employer. The hope is that an employer is at the end. And so the programme would not compare to apprenticeships, which typically have employment built in at the start. But I would use the comparison of the work programme. Our Employability Fund substantially outperforms the work programme statistics, and I'd suggest the committee might have a look at those comparators. I think we outperform at least by three times in respect of similar DWP programmes. So I think it reflects a group of people that have much more complex needs and who are on a journey towards a job opportunity. And for some, that journey may mean a step along the way as opposed to a final job outcome at the end of it.
Just for clarification, because when I met with the Wheatley Group, they did indicate they don't guarantee everybody a job at the end of their modern apprenticeship. What proportion of people going into modern apprenticeships go in with a guarantee of work at the end by the employer?
Well, I think the statistics indicate that the vast majority are retained by the employer. And so 92% being in employment beyond the end of the programme.
There's a guarantee, because what you were suggesting was the difference is that you start with a guarantee of the job for some young people. So presumably there's some who say we're guaranteeing you work at the end of it, others are saying no. What proportion start off from the basis, yes, we'll give you work at the end of it?
Our understanding is that as an apprenticeship, a young person has a contract of employment. Whether at the end of the apprenticeship the employer terminates that contract is something that we would challenge employers on. All of the employers that we're aware of are recruiting apprenticeships with a view to sustaining them and planning for the future workforce. Whether they jump employer at the end of the apprenticeship, in some cases, maybe a large employer might take on five apprentices with a view that three would be ones that they would keep on, and those two other two might be taken on by their supply chain or by competitor employers who maybe aren't directly investing in apprenticeships. But we don't have, unless we survey at the end and at the start and say, what was your purpose here, it's difficult. But they have to have contracts of employment. That's the bottom line.
Danny, you would want to come in earlier.
Thanks. We talk about adults and modern apprenticeships. One of the other key areas, I think, that's unique in Scotland, again, it's been recognised by the OECD, is the all-age careers advice service, information advice and guidance service we provide. It's open to people of all ages. We have a network of 47 centres and 500 locations. In fact, our footprint is in Scotland, of which 364 of them are schools. But the point being, there's resources, there's professional support from careers advisors across the board from people of all ages. So, for example, even with the PACE Redundancy Advisory Service, last year we supported 18,000 individuals within that particular, in terms of support. Over and above that, there was another 30,000 adults who were supported on an individual basis by our careers advisors. So the point being, there's a big infrastructure and support there for the question was asked earlier on about adults in terms of how they can access support through the career information advice and guidance services as well. And I think the other point that Damien talked about youth unemployment, with the participation measure that is now in place, there's just under 230,000 16 to 19-year-olds that we now, with DWP, with local authorities, third sector and others, that we now case manage intensively to make sure they then move on to a positive destination, of which 87.6% in 15-16 were actually in a positive destination. So we want to make sure they access and sustain that. And I think it's a really important point to pick up about the all-age support that we provide from SDS to help individuals of all ages and all abilities and disabilities and interests that are there.
Just to make a quick point, building on Ms. Lamont's questions around STEM and its role within the economy and the fairness of that. We've been working with government, and government yesterday published their STEM consultation document for a new strategy for education and learning. That's going to be open through until January. We're working with our employers and industry leadership groups around making their representation into that. But that is going to be a cross-cutting strategy right from early years through into university. So I would encourage the committee to review that consultation document.
Very much, Ross Greer.
This question very much follows on from James's line of questioning. It was covered quite well by Katie, so it should be relatively brief. It's looking at young people with additional support needs. We know that there's a serious gap there between those with and without additional support needs and the destinations that they reach 9 months a year after school. I was wondering if you could expand a little bit on the training that careers advisors receive and how to support these young people.
That's Danny too.
Thanks for the question. A couple of points. All our careers advisors are all graduates and postgraduate trained and qualified through the university postgraduate course. That's the first thing. And as part of that course, there's elements built in there too in terms of training with people of all needs, including those young people with additional support needs. In addition to that, we also have our Skills Development Scotland Academy, and that particular academy has a number of modules that are there for, we call it the gold standard. We want to make sure our advisors all reach that standard, and particularly included in there, one of the key modules is, again, about additional support needs. We have, in schools just now, we've got somewhere about 370 careers advisors who work in schools. Some of them have got specialisms in additional support needs, but for the rest, what we've done is we've invested in training to make sure they've all got an ability and an awareness of additional support needs to make sure that they can do that. The other point I think it's worth mentioning is I referred earlier on to their needs matrix, and that needs matrix is our careers advisors every year, we negotiate a school partnership agreement with all 364 secondary schools, and contained within that is the issue about targeting pupils. That will include young people with additional support for learning. So, for example, I mentioned earlier on something like 28-29% of pupils in S4 to S6 will have some form of additional support for learning. So it's quite broad in its definition, as you will know. So contained within that particular partnership agreement, we agree with the school, and I mentioned earlier on about the earlier intervention. So traditionally, we had operated mainly from S4 to S6. We now operate from P7, S1, all the way through, so we can work with young people with additional support needs earlier. We work very closely with their parents, in fact, in case conferences with parents and teachers as well. And again, we have what we call, as part of the needs matrix, we have a targeted service. That targeted service makes sure that all the young people with additional support needs. And we have, sitting just now, about 52,000 pupils in the senior phase in schools will be supported through who have various degrees of support through our case conferencing, case management, the careers advisors in schools. So a very extensive support programme, very extensive experience of our staff who are actually delivering it and work very close in partnership with schools and other organisations like psychological services and social work.
What are the mechanisms that you have in place for getting feedback from young people and parents about the support they receive that then allows you to adapt and improve that? Because it's certainly feedback I've found from young people with additional support needs that I've spoken to is that sometimes they felt, not specifically with careers advisors, but in the school environment in general, in moving them onto a positive destination, that their feedback on the support they receive isn't listened to at times?
Yeah, there's various forms of feedback we actually do. The first one, we look at in terms of quality of all the activities and interactions we have with pupils in schools, whether that's on a group basis, and we target every year, was about 150,000 pupils will go through group at work activities with us, and there's evaluation taken from all the pupils who attend that, including those with that broader definition of additional support for learning. We take that feedback and then change and adapt and amend anything we've delivered as part of that. The other thing we do as well is I mentioned earlier on the earlier intervention, we now work across all the secondary schools rolling out the career education standard and developing Scotland's young workforce. And back to Ms. Lamont's point about how it is awareness of careers and opportunities are there. We now attend all parents' nights in S2 and S3 with parents and with teachers to make sure they're aware of the different career pathways and subject choices that they can actually make. So we then have feedback from parents. That we had the recent feedback we did last year with parents who attended those nights, is 82% of parents who actually attended all those nights felt it had been really, really informative and useful in terms of the support the careers advisor could give them and the young person in terms of looking at career pathways and choices. The last point I'd like to mention in terms of evaluation and feedback has been the Education Scotland reviews. To date, we have now completed 14 Education Scotland reviews where colleagues from a Managers Inspector come into schools working with ourselves. And what they do then, they actually interview and speak to young people across all abilities within the schools, talk to teachers, head teachers, and other stakeholders and partners like social work and others as well, and their own staff. And to date, we've had 97% of the results have been good or better. So we'll take a lot on board and a lot of feedback from Education Scotland as well. And the final point I would say, Chair, with Education Scotland has been that many of the areas for development that have come through, and there are a number of areas for development and they're in the Education Scotland website, much of it what talks about in terms of what needs addressed are, it's not just areas for Skills Development Scotland, it's also what can the school do, back to Ms Lamont's point about including how do we raise awareness of careers, and that's why the career education standard is applying back to the point, I think it was Gordon mentioned, nursery, age 3 to 18, so it's that whole range of services and support that we can provide parents, young people, teachers and as well as our advisors.
And Chair, just to add that I think as well as taking feedback on the current service, I think what's really important is to engage, you know, young people, especially with additional support needs, in the service design process. So as we've expanded the career service from P7 to S3 last year, we ran 35 pathfinders right across the length and breadth of Scotland. And the pathfinders were designed by, you know, parents, teachers, young people in the schools in terms of, well, what does it feel like for them? And how would the service be best delivered so that they get the best return out of that? So I think increasingly we've got to engineer the service user and the person who's at the point of receipt into the designing the service in advance of actually launching the service.
Thanks very much, Ross.
Thank you very much, Convener. Questions on modern apprenticeships. First one, actually following on from Joanne's point. I know, Damien, in your answer, you reflected on those over the age of 25 and gaining that support being an emerging issue and looking at that as part of the apprenticeship levy. At the moment, as you'll be aware, in the northeast of Scotland, there's wide-scale redundancies and those redundancies being indiscriminate and there being a critical need to have people retrained in order to find work elsewhere, showing that there's that immediate need. Now, I know that Danny mentioned PACE, but in one of the submissions to the committee, there's actually a criticism that beyond PACE, they feel that SDS has been slow to react in relation to the downturn in oil and gas. So, would there not be logic in perhaps extending the modern apprenticeship to those over 25 to help tackle the immediate and pressing sort of need we have in the northeast just now?
I think it's a good question, and clearly there's a great challenge for the northeast. I'll ask Gordon to comment on the very specific actions that were taken. I sit on the Energy Jobs Task Force, and every member of that task force is absolutely driven by addressing the challenges that are faced in the northeast. I would say to the committee, though, one of the areas that I find most disturbing about the northeast is the lack of challenge back to the employers and to industry. You know, we remarked about 4 or 5 years ago, the industry was challenging government about a skills shortage. You know, there was a lack of engineers, a lack of technicians. Process engineers were being stolen from the whiskey industry and from food and drink to drive up the growth in the sector. And when we looked at that, it was pretty obvious that in the late 70s and the early 80s, a lot of the big companies in oil and gas switched off their investment in training. It takes 14 years to get a chartered engineer. There's an upturn in the industry, and all of a sudden it's government's fault that they don't have the appropriate talent to sustain the industry going forward. So we pull out all the stops to produce rapid transition training funds to stoke up the industry. We then get a shock in the sector, and what's the first reaction from industry is to shed staff. We're directly engaged with all of the trade unions in the oil and gas sector, and some of the behaviours amongst employers and industry in that sector is appalling. So right now, what are they doing? They're shedding staff left, right and centre. There will be an upturn in the sector. There will be an improvement in the price of oil. And we'll be sitting here in 5 years' time arguing about the skill shortages in the sector. So I would say there's something about the committee and Parliament and government shining a light on the practices of industry to maintain a longer-term perspective on their investment in their workforce, so that they, in the good times, they reap the profits, but in the bad times, somehow or another, people become a commodity and they can shed them. So it's something that I've been really, really struck by. But we've taken a huge amount of measures to get on front of people who are facing into redundancy in the Northeast. And we worked intensively with the trade unions to ensure that those messages were getting across. We rely heavily on responsible employers who then anticipate that they might be shedding staff to get in touch with us, to invite us in at an early point and to engage with the workforce. We find that where we get into a company in advance of the announcement of a redundancy and get in front of workers who are under threat, that we can have typically the percentage of those securing a job relatively quickly is about 70%. That approach in oil and gas hasn't happened. There's far more companies that we haven't been invited into than we have been invited into. We've then had to arrange a whole series of events where we try and, you know, communicate through radio and advertisements and others to attract people into different events. So we've ran four separate events, one in the Beach Ballroom in Aberdeen and so on. And the average event attracted 1,000, you know, it was typically on an average day, 1,000 people who felt the need for support. And at those events, we offered a lot of encouragement. We, for most of the events, having interviewed the workers, what they said they valued most was getting in front of an employer. You know, there's lots of nice advice you can give, but what they really needed was the chance to pitch to an employer. We typically had between 50 and 60 employers at many of the events, and certainly the early events where we had people like Scottish Water, we had the nuclear industry, and we had others, they were able to snap up a lot of workers who were emerging during the first phase. But as the challenge has sustained, it's been more difficult, typically because of the salary rates that people are on and I guess the real need to switch quickly to an equivalency. Beyond that, then, Gordon can talk through all of the measures that we're taking. And there's a substantial amount of investment, far more than would be going through the apprenticeship funding in terms of the Transition Training Fund. That Transition Training Fund took a little bit of time to set up because we set it up on the basis of guaranteeing probity for the public money. It would have been easy to give that money away and say, look, anybody who has any need of any training, come to us and we'll pay for half of it or we'll give you any amount of money. We put in place a more stringent process where we wanted to at least challenge the direction and the line of sight of that job opportunity and to test that if the training was undertaking, was there a likelihood that there was a potential for a job opportunity? And equally, was it not going to crowd out other things that might be happening in the labour market, in which case we're paying for somebody to compete for somebody in a job who hadn't had an equivalent support? That fund is now, you know, really progressing very well. I think you've had an update on all of that. Our turnaround times are very quick relative to the information that we've got, and they are absolutely targeting people to equip them with the transition training that they need to get into other sectors. I think the challenge for the oil and gas sector is, you know, and we still ask this question, what volumes of what jobs and what skills and what disciplines are going to be required in the short, medium and long term? And can the industry please engage with us to help us understand that? And that's been a real difficulty. But I'll maybe ask Gordon to comment on the very specific actions that we're taking, because every individual who doesn't have that opportunity to switch from where they are to another job is a challenge.
Just maybe pick up Ross. The first point was, should more apprenticeships be available? And I think we should recognise that a lot of the people that were leaving the industry were highly skilled. So apprenticeships aren't always the best solution for people, particularly when they're coming from a skilled job. And it's more so about how you add to their skills and make their skills a bit more flexible to move them on. Modern apprenticeships are available over the age of 25, and they're available for the key sectors and cross-cutting sectors in areas like road haulage, but across engineering, life sciences, chemical sciences, food and drink. So there are fairly substantial numbers, over 25, and Katie didn't get the chance to give you kind of stats in that area earlier. So in terms of transition training fund, around 2,300 applications made, and so far we've approved 956 applications through the scheme, probably an average cost of about £2,500 there. And as Damien described, we've tried to set up a process where our advisors can work alongside people just to make sure that the programmes that they're applying for are going to be best suited to help them make that step into employment, and certainly getting good feedback through the system and case studies. The trainer market in the northeast, because of the number of agencies, and that's what Damien was referring to, was to make sure that we weren't funding 10 people to say chase the same vacancy. So there's been a degree of interaction between our careers advisors and individuals that are looking at jobs, just to make sure that's going to be a valid use of money, and we'll continue to do that and continue to work with our colleagues in government just to refine the programme and make some subtle changes. We've went through procurement rounds. Individuals can either apply themselves with a prospect, but we've also went to the market through Contract Scotland to ask for employers and other training organisations to come in. So we're currently looking at a second procurement round, and we've got activities in there like smart metering, road haulage, opportunities in terms of employment, and then opportunities around working in the construction sector for the railway industry. So it's two things. We're obviously encouraging individuals to be a bit more self-reliant and identify opportunities, but also trying to look to the wider labour market where there's opportunities. As I said, in terms of the over 25s, there are opportunities there, and if that's appropriate for the individuals, then we'd obviously encourage them to do so. I recognise, and I was disappointed in the feedback that we got for Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce, and I'll meet with James and Dream over the next couple of weeks. We're currently working with them just now in a programme that would look at executives within that have perhaps been displaced from the sector. So we've done some focus group work, and along the lines of like an executive springboard, the numbers of unemployed that have hit the registers across the north of Scotland don't mirror or are not representative of what we'd see in the labour market in terms of those who are registering through the job centre. So we think there's people, and it could be for reasons like they've sat with mortgage protection and other things. So we're trying to just tease some of that out and get people more engaged and getting the type of support that we'll require to make a successful transition.
We make the questions and both and the answers shorter, please, because we still have a lot to go through today. Okay, Ross.
Much, convener. I'll actually try and combine the two questions. It's a quick follow-up to the answer there, Gordon. The Transition Training Fund at the time, when it was announced, obviously a lot of play made at the time that this would help, particularly in relation to the teacher vacancies that we had in the North East. Do you know actually how many people who have applied for the fund have been successful in relation to retraining as teachers? It would be interesting to find that out. And the second point, to Damien, you're absolutely right about challenge to industry. So in relation to the modern apprenticeship scheme, again, some of the feedback from various people who have made submissions is that, in particular, in relation to that programme, it can be quite bureaucratic in a way. I think, you know, 7 full qualification audits, regular compliance audits from SDS, it can be very, very demanding and cumbersome. So when we're trying to encourage that engagement, do you think there's more that could be done to reduce maybe the level of bureaucracy? And one suggestion, again, which I think came from the Chamber of Commerce, was actually to look at maybe a more risk-based model.
Pick up on both of those. I think I contrasted the kind of comment again. It was from Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce with that came from Audit Scotland in terms of their submission to the committee. And it did pick up on the fact that the SDS had good governance arrangements in place and had developed a risk-based approach to audit and process. So we're kind of caught between a rock and a hard place. We can satisfy Audit Scotland in terms of processes, but we've got good structures in place. We do try and make that process with employers and organisations like the Chamber as constructive as possible, because there's our quality development role within there as well. Sorry, I can't remember the first point of your question.
Apologies.
We've got 19 people in the programme just now, and I think our constraints were around some of the conditions from the General Teaching Council. So just very quickly, we've got a working partnership agreement with Aberdeen University, individuals going through a postgraduate qualification in teaching. While they're doing that, they're also performing the role of a classroom assistant, which boosts the classroom time. They have a year's probation, which would be standard coming off the back of the postgraduate programme. And then there's an offer of 2 years employment, and that's split between both Aberdeen City and Shire Council. So a four-year programme. And I think we'll use that. I know government colleagues are interested if this is a model that can be helped address teacher shortages in other areas.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Okay.
Thank you very much. Gillian?
Actually, I answered most of my supplementary questions in the Transition Training Fund. I just want to actually go on record in thanking you for letting me host the Transition Training Fund last week, and it was very valuable to the North East MSPs who attended. I am interested in how you're monitoring the people going through the TTF, into which sectors they're going into, because, you know, kind of following on from Ross's question, with teacher shortages, there are sort of skill shortages in the North East that the people are going into, and how are you monitoring it, and what sectors are you finding that people are finding employment in?
Thanks, and again, thanks for hosting the event last week. The heavier numbers just now are around driving-related occupations, and that tends to be an easy one for people to move over to. So we've had a big interest in areas like road haulage, CPC-type training, which are kind of follow-on in that area. Construction-related, so CSCS cards or CS cards for construction site safety certificates. Also larger numbers in project management, and that's people looking at bolt-on skills, supplementing the skills that they already have, but maybe helping them move in, and that might be conditions that have been attached to employment by some other employers like Prince 2 and others. But we've encouraged people to look across the board, so people may be looking at additional skills to move into self-employment, into food and drink sector, whisky production, that type of thing. So there's a broad range. I can come back with a breakdown of that. And we're currently doing follow-up exercise in terms of the evaluation of how that's working. And I think from the procurement exercise, we're moving to bring some of those areas of higher interest and higher value into the procurement process, and that allows us probably to deliver it a wee bit more cost-effectively. For example, we've been working with the Road Haulage Association in terms of a tailored programme, but we're still going through the procurement steps for these programmes, so probably don't want to say too much at this stage.
I would really appreciate a breakdown. I'm particularly interested in how many people have set up in business. I would like to know those figures, so thank you for offering that.
Okay, thank you, Julian. Tavish, you've got questions on another issue.
Can I ask a couple of questions about the budget, because this is about budget scrutiny. Am I right in saying that your 2016-17 budget is £208 million?
Yeah.
And your expense on people is £65 million?
Yeah, broadly.
Broadly?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's a big chunk of money on people, as opposed to the £116 you spend on national training programmes. Why that balance?
It's to do with careers advisors that we directly employ. So we'd employ between maybe 800 and 900 careers advisors who deliver the services in schools. So we're in over 360 secondary schools directly. We operate...
It's all on the web now.
No,
the high schools
no.
And at home
no,
don't
no.
have a career.
No,
you don't
no,
have a career.
No. I have to correct you, Chair. I have to really correct that. That is an absolute not a truth. We have school partnerships with every school. We have careers advisors dedicated in schools.
But not in schools. They're
yeah, in no, office. In schools. In schools.
Ask a question, get the answer, and then come back.
Yeah, so in schools.
What do you mean by in schools?
They're spending. Careers advisors will spend anywhere up to four days within a school. So they're actually physically in the school for that period of time. And the only reason why they're back in the office again is in the means to pick up and post-school clients or come into the centres, and also to follow up on some of the additional work required for the students that they've already seen.
Arrange for you to visit some schools.
I can go to schools in my constituency, Mr. Yates. I don't need to be told about schools in my constituency. Can I ask you why you said that it was all the oil industry's fault? If you're on the Energy Industry Task Force, you'll know that OPEX has fallen from $32 to $16 a barrel, and oil was at $28 a barrel. What did you expect the industry to do?
Well, I think it's about a measured approach. So I think there's something about retaining some workers. So that's one option. A second option would be to
invest in reskilling them so that they might transition. So a responsible employer might look ahead and actually say, I tell you what, this employee has served me incredibly well, so I have a duty of care to support them to transition out of the sector that I'm in. I mean, some of the practices that I'd maybe recommend you speak to the trade unions about some of the practices that were pretty shoddy.
Did you just say what those practices were?
Well, people arriving at their desk, getting an email saying leave.
Can you give the committee absolute evidence of that?
They discuss SDS and the relationship and how they can bring in apprentices and the others. Let's not veer off into the working practices of the oil and gas industry.
Well, I'm just saying, the chief executive of an organisation made a very serious charge against an industry, and I'm asking him to lay it on the record.
Well, then what you can do is you can write a letter to the committee
with that detail.
With justification.
Okay. Can I then ask the representatives of Skills Development Scotland why the Chamber of the Grampian Chamber say that, and I quote, a one-size-fits-all centralised approach is not working?
It's an interesting question. I'm not sure that the reflection is very well informed. So that's the first thing I'd say. As I said to you already, our delivery is probably the most localised of national agencies. We have individual school partnership agreements with every single school in Scotland. Very, very localised. In respect of the work we do in support of economic development, we've invested a huge amount of money in preparing analysis and future forecasts around labour markets. We've over 40 regional skills assessment plans, which look at the very detail of what happens in very specific regions. If I take, for example, the work we do with the Convention of Highlands and Islands, we produced a very detailed regional skills investment plan covering all of the Highlands Islands region. That plan was supported by individual skills action plans in each of the local authority areas. The services that we deliver are highly responsive. How we deploy our careers advisors in schools are agreed with the head teachers in schools. They're not mandated from the centre. Modern apprenticeships are there to support employers and employer needs. If there is a growth in apprenticeships in a certain area, we should be able to meet that. So I don't recognise some of what the Chamber of Commerce have presented by way of evidence. I'm more than happy to meet with them to challenge that.
To challenge them, I hear you. The Chamber of Commerce also going to say the local SDS team are hardworking, but in our view are under-resourced and do not have a strategic focus given the lack of senior staff based in the region. Is that a fair comment?
No, it's not a fair comment.
Why is it not a fair comment? Why would they
say
that?
Well, as I said to you before, if I work out in the last year or two the amount of time that Danny, Gordon, Katie and I have spent in the Northeast, it's pretty phenomenal. In fact, in the last year or so, we've increased the number of full-time staff in the region. So we've actually resourced the region even further than we had previously to reflect what is a very, very serious priority. So we take the challenges in the Northeast very, very seriously. And we're working incredibly hard to do that. And so all the evidence that I can provide the committee with, as opposed to the anecdote that maybe you're quoting me on. So the facts are, we have more staff in the Northeast now than we've ever had. We are spending more on transition training funds and in other interventions in the Northeast than we've ever had. We are engaged locally with a whole range of partners in support of that. So the facts don't bear scrutiny in respect of the anecdote.
Why do you think then the Chamber of Commerce, I directly quote from their submission to this committee?
Your guess is as good as mine.
Well, I'm not guessing, I'm asking you.
Well, sure, I don't know.
Excuse me, Daniel will be one.
In the Northeast region, we have a senior management team that are actually based there. We have five regions within Skills Development Scotland's structure, of which there's one for that particular area. There's a head of region, there's an area management team, there's team leaders as well, I think, that's where they're based. The second point, in terms of what's available across the country, we are, in terms of the localism that Mr Scott mentioned, was around the community planning partnerships. We're involved in all 32 community planning partnerships at strategic levels. And we're also involved in many of the subgroups, and particularly more recently, the committee will be aware of developments around corporate parenting. We have just launched a corporate parenting plan, and that very much reflects what's going to happen within local geographies. We've got community justice outcome impact assessments and agreements that will be in place by 2017. And again, it's another example where we have to very much work locally within the local area to develop a service and design and deliver a service that meets local needs.
Do you want to come back in?
No.
Okay, supplementary, Richard.
Supplementary, but also
okay,
different right, subjects. So,
right, okay.
Are we going ahead?
Yeah,
firstly, I also
Had the opportunity of visiting Skills Development Scotland's office in Elgin in Moray, and I was impressed by what I heard in terms of the partnership working locally, and also to meet Megan Flett, who's a young woman who's the apprentice actually working for Skills Development Scotland, who's a really, really impressive individual. I just want to pick up on oil and gas issues first, just since it's been mentioned as a supplementary, because it is disconcerting to hear that some of the lessons have not been learnt from the early 2000s. I remember that was a big issue back then, where the oil and gas companies released staff too early and then regretted doing it later on once the price recovered. So it is quite disappointing to hear that that lesson has not been learnt from the early 2000s. I would find it helpful if you could recognise that this is not just an Aberdeen problem. In terms of Moray and rural areas, there are many offshore workers who've lost their jobs in the more rural areas. So can you reassure me that some of the resources and attention to help redeploy oil and gas workers in rural areas is high up on your agenda as well? However, I am aware that some oil and gas workers are retraining as teachers in rural areas, so that's helpful as well. But can you just address that briefly?
I mean, I think the highest numbers around applications for Transition Training Fund have, as you might expect, been in Aberdeen City and Shire. But there's been healthy numbers, I don't know the right terminology, but there's been higher numbers across Fife, Moray, Angus and Highland. So we are working there. Some of the provision we had through our procurement routes as well, related to programme delivery through Inverness College, Tullis Training and others. So we're conscious of that, working with local authority partners as well around that. And there's been a couple of smaller jobs fairs within the rural economy as well.
Okay, thanks. And finally, maybe you can send us some information about what's happening in those areas and the results to the committee. I think that'd be quite helpful. In terms of looking at skills gaps in local areas, not just from the national perspective, and I was also aware of whiskey distilleries losing staff to oil and gas industry a couple of years ago. Maybe they're returning now, as they are maybe to the fishing industry as well. But also interesting to find out if that is the case. How do you approach the national priorities being delivered locally in terms of addressing local skills gaps? Okay. And also, when answering that question, can you address Brexit? Because quite clearly, there are potential skills gaps going to be worsened in some parts of the economy, particularly in rural Scotland, and we have to start thinking ahead as to what the potential scenarios might be. And I just wondered how Brexit's influencing your thinking in terms of anticipating skills gaps.
Okay. Skills Development Scotland, we've started and we had produced 10 sectoral skill investment plans working alongside industry leadership groups, and we're in the process of refreshing those just now. 2 years ago, we then took a further step to produce regional skill assessments, which was taking as much data as we could, both from publicly available sources, but also from partners. So from the Scottish Funding Council in terms of supply, also from Scottish Enterprise, and in this next round, Highlands and Islands Enterprise as well. So it's to look at the demographic profile of the area, build what we could from surveys like the Employer Skills Survey, Workforce Survey at a UK level, but supplement it with as much local information as we could. We produced regional skill assessment documents, but that was also backed up with a data matrix. It was around 56 different data sources that would help organisations, whether it was a local authority, but it was particularly focused on the regional colleges. So worked in conjunction, as I said, with the enterprise agencies, also with the Scottish Funding Council. And between the sector skill investment plans, which we also cut at a regional level, and the regional skill assessments, that gives a local evidence base for the regional colleges to form their views in terms of their outcome agreements. That's worked really well in areas like Highlands and Islands with UHI, but also good examples in rural Scotland around Dumfries and Galloway, who used it. Dumfries and Galloway College used that very much to help with their curriculum planning. Areas like Glasgow, was at Glasgow City Region College event yesterday, there was 90 individuals from across partners and stakeholders hearing inputs from both the Chamber of Commerce, but also a substantial input from our own staff in terms of regional skill assessment for the Glasgow and Clyde Valley area. So we can cut these in a number of ways at a local authority level, at a regional college level, but also in the areas that are looking at things like City Deal, so Inverness. We're working with just now with the three Ayrshires. So very much an analysis there. We undertook a review of the regional skill assessments after the first round. Glasgow University's Training and Employment Research Unit undertook that. We got very good feedback, but also points where they could be improved and some indications of local data, local issues that we had to investigate a bit further. So in the Highlands and Islands, as part of the work we've done through Convention of Highlands and Islands, we've developed local skills plans as well.
Brexit then, in terms of Brexit?
There was obviously a paper and a session at the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Task Committee last week. We're working through the industry leadership groups around those issues, getting reliable data at a Scottish level. So I would refer you to the papers that were produced for the Economy and Jobs and Fair Work Committee last week. That indicated that there was about 128,000 people employed, EU nationals in Scotland, from a working industry leadership group. So obviously aware that there's high concentrations in tourism, food and drink manufacturing sector, and areas like IT as well, IT and financial services. Our fears, and that would be mirrored by the Scottish Government, I think that even if some solution is found for individuals who are currently here or presently here, if there's any blockage to the movement of labour, then that starts to present a real major challenge in the future, because some of that labour will be, some of the existing people that are here will return home or move to other areas. So I think there's real concerns, and that's going to be a focus in our work, both with industry leadership groups, but with other government agencies and government itself, obviously, in terms of how we address these issues. There's some real concerns coming from food and drink companies. And even looking at the Migration Advisory Committee, some concerns coming at that process that it currently stands. If to access people from out with the European Union is too bureaucratic for them to move quickly in terms of the speed that they need to move at as a business. So I think there's challenges ahead, but it's one that we're going to need to do more work on and just identify where there's kind of key areas of challenge.
Ask about the consistency in careers advice, but I think Danny's actually mainly covered that in an earlier point. But what I would like to ask is, following up a bit from what Davish was saying, is there a careers advisor in each school, or is it for an area, and is it a sort of needs-led basis?
Yeah. Thanks for the question. A couple of points here. I mentioned earlier, we have, of the 364 schools, we have in every secondary school what's called a school partnership agreement. And what that basically does is we negotiate and agree with the head teacher and the senior management team within the school the services that we will deliver within that school. And that includes some of the earlier questions around when we have universal services, and that's My World of Work and Group Work and other things. We also have the targeted service. That's about working with young people who fall into the additional support for learning we talked about earlier on, and young people who perhaps might not make a positive destination. But it also includes a number of young people who are very highly academic, have very good qualifications, but there's so many choices they don't know what to do. So we've got to make sure that school partnership agreement reflects the local needs. It's back to the point that Damien said that, yes, SDS has got a core service offering, and that's part of the Scottish Government's Careers Information Advice and Guidance Strategy, which was launched a few years ago. That's then tailored and adopted in terms of how it actually fits with the local needs, the local geographies, because what we deliver in Stranraer will be very different from what we deliver in schools in Glasgow. So that provides that level of, in terms of the consistency. The other point to mention, I talked earlier on about the whole school offer. We now have, for the first time, and across the OECD, sort of keep going on this, but the OECD countries, we have a whole school offer that ranges from P7, S1 right through to S6, and that involves group work, involves one-to-one engagement with young people. But particularly it addresses some of the points that's come up earlier on about subject choice, a lot of work in S2 and S3 with individuals, and also with their parents in terms of what we do there. And again, Damien mentioned earlier on about the early demonstrator schools, 35 early demonstrator schools that were there. We deliberately tried and tested different models with the schools to see what would fit, and that very much reflected local needs. So what we have 371 school-based careers advisors who are actually working in schools. They can be supplemented at various times in different precious and additional work, but the other staff we have in working in our centres, as Damien said, we've got over 900 staff who are actually deployed in delivering the careers information, advice and guidance services that we provide. I mentioned to Mr. response to Mr. Scott's question that we have our establishment plan is on the basis of staff working in schools four and a half days a week. The other half a day they're back in the centres dealing with other clients and other administration as well. So a heavy emphasis and a heavy resource that we've actually allocated to working in schools. Now, we obviously have a lot of work happening in post-school, and I can cover that if you want to. There's a lot of other things happening, but in the school setting, that's where the consistency, that's where and the flexibility and the resource deployment we would have within schools. And at the final point I would make as well is that's then backed up and supported by various forms of evaluation through the head teachers' evaluation, where over 93% of the head teachers saying that what an the significant impact to our particular school partnership agreement had in their outcomes in schools as well, and that very much reflected the local head teachers, local schools arrangements. The final point I would mention as well is about we've had now just completed the 14th of the Education Scotland reviews into all the work of the Careers Information Advice and Guidance Services across the board, but particular emphasis on the work we actually do in schools and the very positive feedback we've had to date. Said over 93% of that's been good or better in terms of the indicators there.
Yeah. Okay, I mean, I would be happy to speak to you out with this meeting about perhaps setting up a date to one of the schools and meet some of the staff in Coatbridge and Creyson, but I'm happy to leave the questioning at that.
We've opened the opportunity to do that. Yeah, thank you.
Daniel?
Well, first of all, I'd just like to echo the thanks in terms of facilitating the visit that I recently made to your office on Shandwick Place. In fact, I'd just like to also mention one thing from that. You provided me with a very good A3 one-pager showing me in an infogram the things that you're delivering. And the one thing I'd say is I wish that every public sector agency produced a similar thing. It made it very clear what you were doing. It was very useful. I mean, I think the work that is happening in terms of skills, and I think the work you're doing is of strategic and national importance. I think we have some very big challenges in terms of raising productivity, raising skills, and coping with skills change. Now, given that, and also given that in 2014 Audit Scotland said that you needed to develop appropriate outcome-based measures, I mean, could you please just sort of step me through how you do measure against those high-level strategic outcomes?
So I think actually the recommendation from Audit Scotland was the Scottish Government as opposed to SDS specifically, but we've taken that on board ourselves in terms of supporting Scottish Government. But just to say that on the broad outcome analysis, Katie has been working for 2 years now with the OECD, and we have engaged the OECD in developing a comprehensive framework for measurement of long-term outcomes. And the outcomes in terms of long-term are really important because, you know, for most of the work that we do, a five-star outcome is somebody securing a job with an investment in skills and the ability to grow in that job and increase their earnings and be able to look after their loved ones and their families and contribute to the economy in a very productive way. But the challenge then from government is, well, how can you demonstrate that that's happened and is being sustained over the long term? So that work has been undertaken now, and it's been undertaken in respect of, you know, sustained employment, earnings. The average contribution per worker in Scotland to the GDP of Scotland is around 27,500. So if productivity goes up, then you would expect that figure to go up. You're looking at career movements. So are they getting job jumps? Are they actually, you know, getting career progression? And then from the employer side, we're looking at measures of productivity around output and increased earnings from new markets and so on. But that's a longitudinal study that will take place over maybe a five-year horizon. But just to reassure the committee that the frameworks and the measures that are required to inform that are now being agreed with probably amongst the best external international evaluators through the OECD. But even today, we can report to you, particularly on the apprenticeships, by way of both qualitative and quantitative data in respect of the outputs and impacts of apprenticeships. So we know that our completion rates are in excess of 78%. We know that 92% sustain employment beyond the life of the apprenticeship. We then survey typically around 2,000 employers and 2,000 apprentices every other year to get qualitative information about what was their experience and what's happened since they have completed the apprenticeship. And again, all of the findings from that, which we can provide you, are very significant. They're in advance of the 70% in terms of the...
So just in terms of the framework you just mentioned there, I mean, when will that be signed off and agreed, and when will you be able to share that?
Answer that one. So first thing that the OECD did was a literature review, and that's now published on the OECD website, and they were looking at best practice across the world on that. So that's out there now. They've now produced the draft framework, and that's going to probably be published this month through OECD. We've now sent that to Scottish Government because the methodology that and it was one that we also thought ourselves, so happily we agreed with OECD in that, for actually tracking long-term outcomes, it's both a complex thing to do with samples, etc., but also it's costly if you do surveys, is actually to link administrative data. So it's linking up your records with HMRC records and also with DWP records. Now, obviously, there's whole sorts of safeguards around there, around confidentiality, etc. So that's seen as the best, the most cost-effective, and it's the way you'll get better returns. If you keep sending out a survey every few years, you'll get diminished returns from it, and your sample size won't enable you to disaggregate, say, by equalities groups or by different areas of the of Scotland, etc., where people live. So that is the kind of gold standard in terms of linking up these administrative data sets.
So I mean, obviously, long-term measures take a long time to wash through, and it's important to have clear KPIs so that you can understand in the short term whether or not, and albeit not in the same way that long-term measures will, how you're performing against this. And I note that was an area of concern that Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce raised. I mean, are you confident that you have adequate KPIs?
I asked the committee to have a look at the Cambridge Policy Consultants report on investment employment services. I think it was published last year. And that report independently verified that of all the agencies, Skills Development Scotland has among the best quality of data, and in fact challenged back out the way in respect of other organisations who maybe don't have as complete a set of data. But I'm more than happy at any point to invite you in and go through all of that data in much more detail. But we have comprehensive range of data, particularly on apprenticeships in terms of the...
So, with all due respect, I mean, I think the point that the Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce were making, not necessarily that the data wasn't there, but was really about how it's presented. So they were suggesting about a balanced scorecard and a kind of a more focused set of KPIs so that we could... so that performance could be tracked. And indeed, I mean, looking at your own submission, your quality assessment section is quite short, and there's really nothing concrete there in terms of precisely what you're measuring in terms of hard measures and hard numbers. So would you think that that's an area for improvement?
I could reverse a truck with reports and evaluations on your desk. So I think it's a question of the balance of what we present to you. But
isn't it that there maybe needs to be a kind of a focused set or a balanced scorecard approach to
provide clarity? We actually operate balanced scorecards internally within Skills Development Scotland, but they're not. We don't publish those as an external.
Do you think that could be a step forward to sort of providing greater
clarity? More than happy to reflect on that, yeah.
So, I mean, I think the other thing I was just interested to look at, I mean, in terms of just anecdotally, my experience talking to apprenticeships is there's quite a broad range of experiences in terms of the content of apprenticeships, ranging from things I've seen at CITB, where it's very, you know, away from the employer, there's a lot of classroom-based content, through to apprenticeships who tell me, well, you know, I get a little bit of online stuff, but not very much external contact. Just in terms of kind of how how do you sort of measure and monitor that sort of external content being provided as part of the apprenticeship? And how does that, I mean, how would you assess that impacts quality, and how do you look at those sorts of quality aspects of what's actually being delivered in terms of external content as part of apprenticeship programmes?
So the inception of modern apprenticeships was built on a policy document called Towards a Skills Revolution, which I'm old enough to remember. And the whole concept behind that was that employers wanted provision that was flexible enough to meet their needs, and also that it should not mirror traditional forms of learning, which were based more on knowledge and less on competence to do the job. So the whole foundation in which a modern apprenticeship built is actually on competence, which is why VQs are a key part of it. So that means that it's different forms of training and learning for different sectors and for different companies, depending on what they're doing. So it's perfectly possible to deliver for some frameworks on the job. There are frameworks which are set by the industry for the industry that determine what the learning is. So, for instance, within the engineering framework, there is a set national certificate qualification that you must do, which can only be delivered by a college. But in terms of retail to develop competence on the job, that's an entirely different matter, and a lot of it can actually be done in the workplace. So actually how that's set is to do with the framework delivery. Also in terms of how an employer wishes it to be delivered, that's a negotiation between the employer and the training provider. We've got a Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board, which was set up in April of this year. And one of the key things that it's going to look at, particularly because of the introduction of the levy, is actually looking at being very clear on what the definition of an apprenticeship is. There's been quite a lot of change in England, which we need to make sure that we come to an accommodation there because of transferability. If you want someone who's finished an apprenticeship to be able to be mobile as well, but you also want the employer to know that what you're getting is what it doesn't attend. So the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board Standards and Frameworks Group will be looking at, actually, is it time to review what the definition of apprenticeship is? A lot because they're concerned about potentially employers rebadging work that they're doing already to access the levy, so there's that thing. When it comes to what we do in terms of monitoring, when we get information in from providers and bidders, we ask them how they're actually going to deliver the learning. In general terms, they might do it differently for specific instances, and we get information on that. And then what we go out and do is we meet thousands of employers and modern apprentices each year to check that actually what they said, what's on the tin is actually delivered. And that's what we're doing all the time. We've changed quite a lot of the focus of what we do, of our contract managers, to be out meeting the customer rather than too much with the supplier. Education Scotland also have now been undertaking inspection of off-the-job training that's been going on. There was an engineering report out previously, and there's one for hairdressing due out, I think, this month as well. So there's quite a lot of activity that goes on around quality review to look at, but I think clearly within the context of what an apprenticeship is, it's horses for courses depending on the framework and the company.
What you described there, I think, is quite a broad range of different things. In terms of some apprenticeships having quite deep technical skills and some less so. I mean, do you have any measures in terms of assessing the value add that either particular apprenticeships are delivering, or indeed the apprenticeship system as a whole is adding in terms of?
What we'll do is, I mean, within the context of a survey of 2,500 employers and 2,000 individuals, what we've been looking at recently is disaggregating by broad occupational framework to see the differences in terms of things like, do they tend to train new recruits? Do they tend not to do that? Satisfaction with the level of the training. So we can disaggregate by framework, broad occupational group, to look at the differences there. I have to say, in general, satisfaction levels are high across the piece.
Is value add, though?
Well, the value add, there are measures of value add in that, and I can talk to you about that if you want.
Great, thank you.
Ross, did you want to come back in?
It was just a quick point, so following on from Tavish's line of questioning, and it's just a brief point and hopefully a positive response. In the Chamber of Commerce statement, one thing that did ring alarm bells with me coming from business leaders was that it had been difficult to establish partnership working with SDS. Mm-hmm. So I would be just grateful. I mean, what sort of immediate steps do you think SDS can take now to get that partnership working in place to address the concerns?
Again, I challenge back the evidence that's been presented by the Chamber, and I'll ask Gordon to offer, because the facts don't bear the evidence was presented, and I'll ask Gordon maybe to present the facts about our intensive engagement with industry.
I think picking up in the Chamber itself, we've been working from the back of a regional skill assessment with partners in the local authority, college, two universities and the Chamber to produce a regional skill investment plan. James has been directly involved in that process, and that's why communicated back disappointed with the comment. Aberdeen Chamber hosts the North East's Regional Developing Young Workforce Group. Mike Duncan, who's one of our senior team is on the board of that senior group, so I'm a wee bit at loss given the reference there. And as I said, I've got a meeting planned with James just to distill where some of these issues have came from.
Yes, that would be useful. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Gillian, would you want to come back in, or did you think?
Yeah, a brief question. Given that Scotland's economy is mainly made up with SMEs, I wanted to ask you about how you are facilitating shared apprenticeships. Obviously, you'll know the challenges there. You know, you've got small businesses who maybe feel that they can't take advantage of the apprenticeship programme because they don't have the staff to deal with them. So shared apprenticeships probably going to be the key to quite a lot of our participation in this, and I just wanted to know your thoughts on that.
Yeah, we have been working on that. That's been a bit of an uphill struggle, to be honest. It's been hard to get some companies engaged in that, partly because you've got to have somebody as the employer. You know, every employer, every apprentice has got to have a contract of employment. That's part of it as well. So we have got some pilots, I think, in the Dundee area around construction at the moment, I think in one in Highlands and Islands, and we're also working on an arts-related one, a creative one as well, but it has been quite slow. We've been trying to push it as much as we can, but I think in terms of companies also aren't necessarily that keen on, you know, working with somebody, then they go somewhere else and all that sort of thing. They all want them at the same time and all that sort of thing. So there are quite a lot of logistical issues, but we are going to keep plugging away at that.
Just to reassure the committee chair that 2/3 of the current apprenticeships are with small to medium-sized businesses. I think what Ms. Martin might be referring to is often micro-businesses of 5 to 10 employees, and absolutely I can see the need for joined up. The challenge then is who's prepared to stand up and say, well, I'll be the host employer, and then how do we manage the system? But we're very open to addressing the barriers. As Katie said, we've got a number of pathfinders, and in principle what you suggest seems to be a great solution, but when we try to apply it in practice, it doesn't just seem to work quite as well. I've had a look at a similar system in Norway, but government adopts the intermediary position, and so government becomes the guarantor of the employed status, and it then facilitates the micro businesses to engage, and then it kind of passes them out, and it's almost like an intermediary labour market position. So I guess, you know, one of the options we could present to government might be that, you know, in the absence of very small businesses being prepared to take on that risk, is there a midpoint where government might be prepared to take on that risk? That's not without its challenges, as you could imagine, but we're very live to it, and if we can make it work more and make it more wide scale, I'd be very open to it, but subject to that the individual doesn't suffer in respect of that employed status and the guarantee of progression.
So is there, I mean, in terms of flexibility of the type of apprenticeships you maybe offer, maybe could that be the key, maybe have a flexibility around maybe more project-based type of apprenticeships and sharing that way in terms of, you know, small businesses might recruit some as an apprentice to help with a particular project?
I think as long as it meets the requirements of the framework in terms of demonstrating competence in that occupation. And sometimes project work is seen as a bit of sort of training for stock. It's not actually a real job that you're doing. So it's just about making sure. But there are, you know, there are ways of looking at that. But you have to meet the requirements of the framework. And that's a requirement for the registration, the Sector Skills Council, etc.
So what outreach are you doing with the smaller businesses to sort of, like, you know, look at their concerns, is maybe the wrong word, but maybe their issues about taking on apprenticeships?
Yeah, I mean, Federation of Small Business undertook a piece of work through Rocket Science Consultancy several years back, and we've used that in terms of our kind of focus in terms of how we work with particularly micro businesses. So we have a team of employment engagement advisors that are based on a regional basis, and we'll do engagement through Federation and through the Chambers of Commerce in terms of promotional events, one-to-many presentations, but also go out and actually sit and help them kind of distill what their requirements are. Again, solutions aren't always the apprenticeship programme. There might be other solutions there in terms of recruitment of a more mature person, or working through the college in terms of work experience and work experience internships, that type of activity. So we've got two skill investment advisors per region, and again, we've got a web service, our skills force, and that's connected into our contact centre as well. So there's online and telephone support as well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So the one last question from Joanne Lantz.
Yeah.
And some brief answers.
Please.
Yeah, I mean, just to say there are a number of other issues that highlights us by other organisations we're not going to be able to get through today. I wouldn't want to think it was only Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce had tough things to say, but maybe we can pursue through the clerks and the convener some of these issues that have been highlighted to get a response. I just was interested in your view on a fair work agenda in relation to the amount of public investment that's going to support employers to support modern apprenticeships and employability initiatives and so on. What view do you have, or what guarantees can you give us on the quality of the work that people are maybe involved in? What are the expectations of employers that you would put on them? And have you had any thoughts around how the business pledge could actually incorporate some of good practice around support for training and apprenticeships more generally?
Starting that. So I think it's a good question, and it's at the heart of that more inclusive economy that I think that everybody wants, that people get the opportunity, as I said before, to get a decent wage, to get decent progression, and to be in a workplace that values them. And so all of the work that we do, as we say, on apprenticeships is about, you know, those two outcomes of a job, but with an investment in skills. And as a proxy for, you know, the best chance in terms of progression, I think that's amongst some of the best in terms of interventions. We've been doing a lot of work to, you know, promote what is best practice in respect of fair work. Where do we see examples of workplaces that have highly engaging workforce strategies, where people are seen as the principal asset of the business and where the investment in them is significant? And that's something that we'll continue to do. It's not our primary responsibility, but it's certainly a horizontal theme in all of what we do going forward. And maybe ask Katie to pick up on some of the other.
I think in terms of going forward, one of the areas that we've been thinking about is in the levy, and we don't know yet what money's going to come from the levy to us, but you know, there may be an opportunity there in terms of securing the funds back the way around putting maybe some measures in place to say around fair work agenda and the equalities agenda in particular to say, well, you know, can you demonstrate what you're doing to recruit from a wider talent pool and all that sort of stuff. So I think there's maybe some things that the levy might give you to actually put more of a stick back to the things that you were talking about earlier in the session again there.
If there's public investment, would you have expectations, at least through the conversations, about what is deemed to be fair work, and that there would be reasonable expectations of employers that, you know, once the apprenticeship is concluded and if they're going to have a job, then we would expect things that the business pledge identifies around wage rates, end to 0 hours contracts, the engagement within the workforce. I mean, do you see yourself having any role around that agenda around fair work?
Yes, but it's how far it goes, because I think the government has you know, stepped back one step from actually mandating it, or in respect of procurement contracts for public services, do we mandate that people can demonstrate fair working practice? So I think it's the degree to which the committee would think we would go to. So all of what you said, I would support 100%. And we have an important role to ensure that those employers that we engage with are demonstrating those practices. How far can we take that? I'm not really sure. But it goes back to the point of mandation. So, you know, would the committee recommend that any business in receipt of public funds should have a mandation to demonstrate a commitment to fair working practices and to the business pledge and to the living wage and so on? And that's a matter for government.
I understand, because we the previous Parliament Economy Committee did an inquiry into this, and we understand the distinction between voluntary and mandatory. I'm sure the government, this will be something that they will be looking at. But it's a parallel question, really. For example, we questioned the DWP would ever sanction somebody for not taking work when that work was in a 0 hours contract with no guarantees and very poor conditions. There was a bit of dissemblance of what the answer to that was. So my question to you, I guess, is have you got an agenda around the employers that you're engaging with? There are some employers you simply wouldn't engage with on the basis that you've not got reasonable guarantees around respect for the workforce and the conditions in which people will be working.
The answer to that is yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to the end of the session. Thank you very much for your time this morning. And I would ask the public gallery to now close. We're now going into private session. Thanks once again.